So this is a conference for Simon's Foundation Support Conference for Homological Mirror Symmetry. But this will go somewhat beyond that as far as there's some content. And we are glad that we have many people coming from Hong Kong, which is more than what I expect. Led by Coleman Lair. So that's a good, good collaboration. And so this is supposed to be a learning seminar and try to do research. So we hope we will actively discuss a lot of the problems that we want to solve. So although the fund is supposed, the research fund is supposed to support homological mirror symmetry, but I think we can do something as long as it's interesting. Okay, Lau is going to chair.
Yeah, we are happy to have Hiro Tanaka, who is now at Harvard. So he's talking about floor theory and spectral theory.
Cool.
I think it's on, yeah.
It's on.
Can you hear me? Yeah, I hear something.
The video is on.
Yeah, there it is.
Okay, it says status recording. It's not counting anything, but that's okay.
Yeah,
sure. Sounds right.
Okay, great. Well, thank you to the organizers for inviting me. The title of the talk is way more ambitious than what the actual lectures are going to be about. And in particular, I don't know if I'll actually be able to explain what spectra are, but that's one of the goals as we go along. But let me tell you somehow a motivating conjecture that frames a lot of this two-part lecture series. Okay, so here's the easiest version of the conjecture. So let's let capital M be a Liouville domain. So if you don't know what this is, you should just think that M is some sort of non-compact symplectic manifold, which is exact. So its symplectic form is the derivative of some one form that we're interested in. And the conjecture is that there exists an equivalence between two categories. And what are the two categories? Well, when your manifold M is non-compact, you could also consider Lagrangians that are non-compact. And there's several different kinds of open string theory that you can consider on these non-compact brains. And the kind that I'm going to take for this conjecture is the Rapp-Fukaya category of M. So roughly the objects are brains, but they're allowed to be non-compact, and far apart brains can actually interact. The Hamiltonian isotopies that we choose to deform these non-compact Lagrangians have incredibly large deformations near infinity. So even if two Lagrangians are far apart, they might interact because of this very large Hamiltonian. So this is a kind of Fukaya category that lets far apart non-compact objects speak with each other. Okay, so that's usual floor theory. It involves the usual notion of holomorphic curves, etc. And on the other side of this equivalence is a category that involves no holomorphic disks. I denoted lag of them. And it's some infinity category of Lagrangian cobordisms. And the most important part, the most important aspect of this category that I want to emphasize right now is there's no disks. You don't need any notion of holomorphic disks to define this left-hand side. Okay. And so roughly speaking, the conjecture is supposed to predict an equivalence between these two categories. However, there's a bit of a detail, which is, so this category has some structure. Just like the Rapp-Fukaya category always has chain complexes as their morphisms, this is always going to have some algebraic gadget as its morphisms. But these gadgets are never chain complexes, they're spectra. Now, all chain complexes are chain complexes of abelian groups, and in particular, they're chain complexes of Z modules. Okay? So they always have an action by the ring of integers. And so one aspect of this conjecture is that there's actually some universal ring spectrum called L. So this is some ring. So a spectrum in general is just something that's much more algebraically robust than a chain complex. And the claim is all the objects here are linear over this ring spectrum L. And that this ring has a map to the integers. So it makes sense then to tensor this category with the integers. Okay. So now at least both sides look like they're linear over the integers, and you have a hope that there's an equivalence between these two categories. But there's yet another algebraic modification that we have to do, which is the usual thing in mirror symmetry, which is the Fukaya category is too geometric in some sense. because its objects are Lagrangians and because its morphisms are constructed by intersections and holomorphic disks, you don't expect it to have any nice algebraic properties. For instance, things like mapping cones and quotients.
It's not geometric enough.
Say that again?
I think it's not geometric enough.
I see, right. So another perspective on this is that you haven't included enough Lagrangians, like singular ones. Yeah. So that's, of course, a conjectural way to enlarge the Rad-Fukaya category. Okay. So whether or not you want to make it more geometric or more algebraic, because I know nothing about singularity theory for immersed Lagrangians and the like, I'm going to make this more algebraic. So I'm going to take some algebraic completion that gives it nice algebraic properties, the kind that dbco has, for instance. And I have to do the same thing on the left-hand side. Okay, so that's the motivating conjecture, which is that the right-hand side has a category that, you know, is intimately involved with holomorphic disks and Gromov-Witten theory. The left-hand side has none of that. And yet you still have those equivalents. So this is a motivating conjecture. And so let me just make some remarks about it. If you've done Floer theory before, you know that there's a lot of choices involved in defining some sort of Fukaya category. Not least of which is, do you want to decorate your brains? Do you want to give them things like gratings, like spin structures, etc.? So one remark I want to make is that you can change the decorations on your brains. These Lagrangians inside of N. And what this will have the effect of is this changes just the rings involved. For instance, if you never choose a spin structure, then the Rad-Fukaya category is not Z-linear, it's Z-mod 2 Z-linear. And the second remark that I want to make is this L does not depend on M. So the claim is once you choose a certain kind of structure that you want on all of your objects in the Fukaya category, there's a single ring spectrum that controls all of Lagrangian cobordism theory for all the available domains M. Okay? Just like regardless of what symplectic manifold M you're on, the Rad-Fukaya category is always Z-linear. And then the third and final remark, which I think makes this far more interesting, is this conjecture seems to hold with some modifications. For non-Liouville M. So, as we'll see later on in this lecture series, the notion of Lagrangian cobordisms doesn't at all depend on the Liouvilleness of M. Usually the reason that you put this Liouville condition on M on the right-hand side is to get Gromov compactness and to have some good notion of really big wrapping. But you don't need any of that to define Lagrangian cobordisms. And for instance, so let me just say, I think their work is yet unpublished, but if you can find a copy of some seminar talks that Biran and Cornea have been giving. For instance, in the monotone setting, if you can incorporate immersed Lagrangian cobordisms, then they seem to have a result that says that the Fukaya category for monotone symplectics is equivalent to some version of the Lagrangian cobordism category. So in either case, you can actually describe the Fukaya category without using holomorphic disks. So one way to think about this is it's as though all along we've just been computing the singular homology of some gadget, and this Lagrangian cobordism thing is the gadget that we've been computing singular homology of each time we've been computing the Fukaya category. That's one way to think about this. Okay, so depending on your background, hopefully this conjecture was motivating. Depending on your background, it wasn't motivating at all. So I apologize for that. But what are the goals of my two lectures?
Is it B analog?
Say that again?
Is it B analog on the other side?
So is there a B analog? The B analog is just algebraic geometry over spectra.
So what spectrum? What is the spectrum?
It's whatever the spectrum L is, and we don't know what, we can define it, we can't compute it. So maybe I should make some. So let me just make another remark. Maybe this will be remark 4. So the point is, so let's stick with nothing being, say, matrix factorizations, just to make it easy. So let's say that you have this Rad-Fukaya category of M. And let's say that this is equivalent to dbco of some gadget. Okay. Let's say that you know that tensoring by Z is what renders the equivalence between this Lagrangian cobordism category and the Rapp-Sakai category. Then what you can hope for, so I'll put this as a question mark, is that this is, again, equivalent to DB co of some gadget. Now, usually, for instance, if this is Z linear, then you can hope that this is DB co of some N check, where this is some Z scheme or Z stack. Usually, in mirror symmetry, we take some complex variety, like some complex Calabi-Yau variety, and we take DB co to be equivalent to some Fukaya category, and both are C linear, or at least linear of some Novikov parameter if you care about the large volume limit. Here, because I'm in a Liouville domain, I'm not going to compactify anything. I don't care about the Novikov parameter, and I'm just looking at just the base coefficients of your ring. And the point is, this M check could be just a Z scheme, so defined using integer equations rather than complex equations. And likewise, if you now try to enrich this mirror symmetry over into the setting of spectra, then what you might hope for is some mirror M check, where this is actually some sort of scheme, let's say over the base ring spectrum L. So it's some space that's glowed up, not of affine schemes that are Z linear rings, but are affine schemes that are L linear rings. Okay. Of course, Z linear rings is another word for rings. So for this to make any sense, of course, you need to know that, that I'm working in the setting of spectra. Otherwise, there's no generalization. Okay.
Is these two M check the same M check?
No, sorry. So maybe I'll check Z. Are there any other questions? I guess as Yao said, we want discussions. So always feel free to interrupt and ask questions, however stupid they may seem.
Do you have a one-dimensional example?
Say again?
About this picture in one dimension, can you spell it out exactly what that is?
Ah, so like, do I have any examples?
Yeah.
Is that the question?
Yeah.
Yeah, so the only examples that one can prove for sure right now are just cotangent bundles of Rn, which are obviously incredibly poor examples. But the point is, the reason that you expect such an equivalence like this is that you expect both sides to have a local to global property. This is one of those famous conjectures of Kontsevich that the Rapp-Sakai category actually glues categorically from a local to global object. And because cobordisms are inherently objects that you can patch together, you expect the same local to global phenomenon here. So when you can prove it for T star Rn, using the local to global property, you can at least try to prove it for cotangent bundles. And at least you can check that in the case of T star S1.
Sorry, can you just say that on the Lagrangian cobordism side, what we know is already have a global to global property?
No, that's what you expect. Actually, so proving it is pretty difficult because you need to take colimits of stable infinity categories, and that's a difficult problem in general. It's what you expect, but it has not been proven. I mean, just like the Kontsevich conjecture for the Rapp category, I mean, it was conjectured by Kontsevich. Now Ganatra, Pardin, and Shenda claim that they have a proof, and they've given talks about various aspects of the proof, but it hasn't been written yet. Okay, so both sides have this expectation. And you can actually work out that for the cotangent bundle of the circle, you do actually get a spectral scheme called GM. I always forget whether it's GL1 or GM because they're different over spectrum, but it's the thing that you get when you get when you attach one free invertible generator to your base ring. So you can check that that works out on this side. Okay, so those are so in terms of the equivalence, cotangent bundles are an expected example. Cotangent bundles of Rn are an example. And in terms of mirror, so far T star S1 is the only example in which
what
is L?
Yeah.
It's the same L for every M.
But it's explicit.
Yeah, so I'll get to that later. Yeah. It's endomorphisms of a point, if you like. That's a geometric description that doesn't tell you what it is. OK. Should I move on? OK, so I wanted to tell you what some of the goals are for this lecture series. So one of the goals that I wanted to establish in this lecture series, goal zero, is just explain some of the tools and mechanisms, or the tools or techniques, I guess, that goes into trying to prove a conjecture like this. And to even state this conjecture, I mean, I use the word categories. In fact, I use the word infinity category in the lower left corner there. And I thought this would be a good chance, because this is a workshop, to at least introduce the mechanism of infinity categories. So this includes infinity categories. And if we have the time, spectra and stable infinity categories. So even if you don't take away any floor theory from these sets of lectures, I think if you came away comfortable with infinity categories, I would feel quite happy, like I accomplished one goal. So another goal is to give some evidence. So one evidence is that you can actually construct a functor that would arise from this conjecture being true. So I can construct a pairing. So it's going to be some functor from the category of Lagrangian cobordisms on M to modules over not the entire Rapp-Fapad category of N, but over the compact objects. Not compact in the sense of category theory, but in the sense of brains. These brains are compact Lagrangians. And so the reason that this is evidence is because there's always a pairing between the compact objects of the Rapp-Fapad category and all the objects of the Rapp-Fapad category. So you would expect that if you have such an equivalence, then you'd expect a pairing like this. Okay. Oh, and let me tell you why this is a pairing. By adjunction, this is the same thing. As a functor like this. And so this is a pairing between Lagrangian cobordisms and the compact Rapp-Fapad category. Okay. So these are the same thing.
You write down on the right hand side, what is this?
The chain complex over Z. And this is modules.
Yeah. Mod for modules.
And again, I doubt that we're going to have time for this, but the second or the third goal of this bunch of lecture series is establish or sketch the ring map to the integers. Of course, this entire tensoring operation is premised on that. Okay. So I'm going to jump right into some real mathematics now. Let's start with goal zero. Here's an introduction to infinity categories. Okay. Let's first start with categories. So the main idea of building up to infinity categories is to reduce category theory concrete combinatorics. Okay. And so the combinatorics of what? The combinatorics of simplices. So before I get to infinity categories, I want to talk about ordinary categories. How do you know what a category is? Like if somebody gives you a category C, what is a way to probe it? Well, if you think about it for a second, the only reason you care about categories is often by studying maps to and from categories, in other words, functors. Just like the main meat you get out of groups is by studying group homomorphisms. In a similar way, the meat that you get out of categories is by studying functors between them. And how do you verify when you have a functor between two categories? Well, you verify it by checking that commutative diagrams are sent to commutative diagrams. This is another way of saying composition is respected. So the key idea here is, categories are captured by the commutative diagrams. And so now the question is, okay, so if I can articulate all the commutative diagrams of a category, I know the category itself. But what are all commutative diagrams built out of? You normally see commutative squares. But, of course, squares are built out of triangles. So the simplest kinds of commutative diagrams are diagrams in the shape of simplices. Okay. So categories are captured by their commutative diagrams, the simplest of which are commutative n simplices. So let me give you an example. Here's an example. Let's see the category. And let's assume that it's small. So that the collection of objects is a set, and the set of morphisms between any two objects is a set. Those are the kinds of categories that we'll tend to deal with in the Fukaya world anyway, because everything is a submanifold of M, and M is a set. Okay, so let's say be a small category. So here's the definition. The nerve of C is the data of so a set Ci for every integer greater than or equal to 0, where C0 is just the set of objects of C. Okay. So you should think of these as the commutative zero simplices. This is just the same thing as giving functors from a zero simplex to C. The zero simplex is just a point. And what's C1? C1 is just a set of all morphisms in C. Okay. How do you pick out a morphism? This is just the same thing as a functor from something called the one simplex into C. So the one simplex is a category which consists of two objects and a single morphism between them. And more generally, CK is just a set of commutative k simplices in C. So just as an example, C2 is just a set of diagrams in this shape. You have morphisms F01, F12, and F02, and F02 equals the composition. So this is some just combinatorial data, just a collection of sets, together with maps. So together with identity and composition maps. Okay, so first let me explain the identity maps. So let's say that I have some diagram in the shape of an n-simplex. So this is a diagram with x0, x1, x2, all the way up to xn. And of course, we have arrows from x0 to x2, all that. Okay. So because we're in a category, actually this commutative diagram is specified exactly by just giving the edges from x0 to x1, from x1 to x2, etc. Because all the other edges can be determined by composition. But what I can do is I can choose the ith spot. And I can insert the identity there. Okay. So now, I started with a diagram consisting of an n simplex. And now this gives me a diagram consisting of an n plus 1 simplex. So these are what are called the identity maps, and sometimes they're also called degeneracy maps. Okay. So this is the map SI. And those are the identity maps. Let me tell you what the composition maps are. And the composition maps are DI from CN plus 1 to CN. How do these go? Well, if I have some commutative diagrams in the shape of an n plus 1 symplex. Okay. I can just take these morphisms, and I can compose. So maybe I should draw an example in the case of 2 and 3 simplices, just to make it obvious. Okay. So what's going on here is, so just as an example, so the zeroth degeneracy map, S0, will give you a commutative tetrahedron. Like so. Okay. Once you insert the identity map here, there's a unique way to fill in this tetrahedron. And let's say that I take, for instance, the first face map here. Then I'd end up with a commutative diagram that looks like this. Okay. And these satisfy some relations. Simplicial relations, which I'm not going to articulate. Okay. So the point is, I've wasted a lot of your time. I've taken this beautiful gadget called a small category, and I've reduced it to a collection of three kinds of data. One, a collection of sets. And two, a collection of identity maps. And three, a collection of face maps or composition maps. And the claim is, this completely captures the data of a category. Okay. So through that, I need to articulate some things. Okay. Okay. So remark. So let's make concrete the notion of this category called delta n. So let's let bracket n denote the poset, consisting of n plus 1 elements. It's the usual linearly ordered poset. It's a sub-poset of the integers. It's the usual less than or equal to relation. Then by a functor from delta n to c, we need a functor from brackets n to c. So here's a definition. We let delta be the category whose objects are, so there's one object for every non-negative integer called bracket n, and whose morphisms are functors. Or same thing as order-preserving maps, or poset maps. It's an easy exercise to check that a map between posets that respects the ordering is the same thing as a functor between the associated categories. Okay. So one thing that I'm implicitly using here is any poset defines a category in the obvious way. There's a, yeah, so the objects are in bijection with the set n, and the set of morphisms in this category is empty if it's going the wrong way, and it's just a single point if the relation I to j is going the correct way. So the upshot is that the node of C is determined is the same thing as a functor contravariant out of this category is the category of sets. Okay? So let me just articulate how this goes. So for instance, there's an object in here called bracket 0. It's a poset consisting of only one element. And you can send this to the set C0, which, if you recall, I defined to be the object. Okay? And so this is the same thing as the collection of functors from bracket N, from bracket 0. Okay? And likewise, this is sent to C1, which is the arrows of C0. And this is the same thing as the collection of functors from 1 to C. And so forth. Okay. In other words, this is just the functor represented by C. Okay. So let's now generalize this. Okay. So what I've managed to do is I've taken this beautiful data of a category C and I just reduced it down to a single functor. Okay. So the upshot is N of C is the same thing as the data of C itself. And so we've given a purely combinatorial way of encoding just ordinary categories where composition holds on the nodes. But if you do Foucault category type things, you know that there's much more subtle notions of categories, ones in which compositions don't need to be associative on the nodes, for instance, but only associative up to homotopy. And the reason that I've taken you this entire boring combinatorial mess is it turns out that functors like this also very naturally capture the notion of categories with a composition that only holds up to homotopy. So let me explain how that goes. So as it turns out, so the roadmap is any infinity, so any category with notion of homotopies can also be encoded as a functor from delta op. So let me give the definition. Okay, cool. So here's a pre-definition. So definition one, a simplicial set, capital X, is a functor from delta op. Here's definition two. The ith n-horn is the simplicial set obtained from the n-simplex by removing its interior and its I space. So let me articulate what this definition means. So by the n simplex, we mean the functor represented by bracket n. So here's a remark. For any integer that's not negative, we have a simplicial set from delta op to sets. It's given by just taking an arbitrary element like a k and sending it to a collection of functors from k into a fixed n. I mean, bracket n is just an object in this category, so it always represents a functor called what are the morphisms into it. And this is what I've been calling the n symbol. Now, because you're looking at functors into sets, with sets you can glue things. You have colimits. You can take unions of things. You can mod out by relations. You can take products, etc. And so the collection of all functors from delta op to sets inherits all these nice properties. So while geometrically you can take, say, a two simplex, and you can draw this, and you can draw what remains when you delete the, say, first face and the interior, you just get a wedge of two edges like this. So what I've informally defined as deleting the interior and the ith face of a simplex, you can formally define as a union of certain faces of the n-simplex. Okay? So it's actually gluing together certain functors like this. That's what I mean by the ith face, by the ith n-horn. And let me give it some notation. That's what I mean by the ith n-horn. So let me just draw some pictures. This is an example. What's the 0-2 horn? Well, I draw the 2 simplex. Okay. I remove its interior, and I remove its 0th face. So it's a union of two edges glued along this vertex 0. Landing to 1 is the same thing, except I've removed the first face. So the ith face is the face opposite the ith vertex. And then the 2-2 is obtained as cell. Okay. And here's an observation. So if a simplicial set is given by the nerve of some category, which I defined, then the following diagram always fills. So let's say that I have a simplicial set called lambda 2, 1. And let's say that I'm given a map of simplicial sets to the nerve of C. I forgot to say what a map of simplicial sets is. So a map of simplicial sets is a natural transformation. A map from X to X prime is a natural transformation. So let's parse what this means. So to give a map like this to the nerve of C, as I've drawn, it's the same as giving the data of two edges in the nerve of C that happen to glue along the same vertex here. So this is the same amount of data as just picking out two objects, or three objects, x0, x1, and x2, and a morphism from one to the other. It's the same amount of data. Now, by definition, if I've removed a face and an interior from the 2-simplex, the remainder obviously includes into the 2-simplex. And one can ask whether or not I can find a map of simplicial sets from delta 2 to the nerve. And the point is, you always can if this is the nerve of a category. Because you can always take this diagram and complete it to a commutative diagram. Right? Because there's something called composition. And not only that, so this arrow always exists, but this arrow always exists uniquely, because composition is uniquely defined for a category. If you have two morphisms, there's a unique thing called their composition. Okay. And more generally, here's an exercise. For every I that's strictly between 0 and n, you can always include the ith n horn into the n-simplex, and this commutative diagram can always be filled uniquely. Now, at this point, you might be noticing what the difference is between a category that's strict like C and a higher category. In a higher category, when somebody gives you two arrows that looks like this, from x0 to x1 and x1 to x2, there's a unique way to fill it. Okay? Or in an ordinary category, there's a unique way to fill it. In a higher category, you might be able to find, say, some edge from x0 to x2 that can fill this diagram. But this edge might not be unique, and the homotopy that you choose to fill in the simplex might not be unique. Right? This happens all the time. So the point is, if we wanted to generalize the notion of a strict category to a higher category, it just seems like we need to relax the uniqueness condition. That's exactly what we're going to do. definition. An infinity category is a simplicial set C such that for all n greater than or equal to 0, and for all I strictly between 0 and n, which means that you only need to consider n greater than or equal to 2, this diagram can always be filled. In other words, i.e., given f, there exists this f bar. It makes this diagram commit. Okay. So it seems kind of like a dumb, really just kid's play toy definition. We've really just defined an infinity category to just be a collection of simplices, and one in which horns can always be filled so long as they're inner horns. That's all it is. It's almost a dumb definition. But the crazy thing is, this is the most effective definition of higher categories that I know of. And if I have time later in this lecture series, hopefully I can explain why they're so effective. Okay, so let me make a remark. One can exhibit an equivalence as follows. So let's consider the category of categories. Okay. So this is like ordinary categories. There's no infinity. Category in the sense that we all grew up with as little children. And look at the category of infinity categories for which these F bars are unique. So remember, when we started off with a category, we had a way of producing an infinity category by taking this construction called the nerve. We produced a functor, we produced a simplicial set called the nerve. And you know, this observation in this exercise shows that not only do these feelings exist, right, and therefore these are infinity categories, they exist uniquely. Okay? So this nerve association always lands in the set of infinity categories for which these F bars are unique. Okay? And so the point is, one can this is actually an equivalence. So in other words, whatever you meant by classical category theory, whatever you could phrase there, you can phrase completely in terms of infinity categories satisfying this unique horn filling condition. And of course, this sits inside all infinity categories. So this inclusion is a mathematically precise way to articulate the notion in which higher category theory is a generalization of ordinary category theory. So let me just give a bunch of concrete examples, because I think that's the fun of it. You had a hand up? Or? Okay. So all this would be dumb if I didn't give you some examples. Okay. So let me give some examples. So here's maybe an example that a lot of people here care about, which is DG categories. So claim is any DG category, there's a natural construction to turn it into a simplicial set that happens to be an infinity category. Okay, so let's fix a DG category called A. Okay. Then we can construct an infinity category that I'll call the DG nerve of A as follows. Okay. And remember how we constructed the nerve of a category C? We just probed C by simplices. And that's how we constructed the nerve. We're just going to do the exact same thing here. All we need is a model for simplices that lives in the DG category world. So, informally define DG categories bracket and DG as follows. Okay. So first, let's bracket 0 DG. It's just going to be also, yeah, okay. So it's just going to consist of a single object with just the identity morphism. Okay, so that's a nice DG category. It's called the endomorphism. The endomorphism algebra is just the integers. It's definitely a DG category. OK, so note that if we look at the collection of DG functors from this category into A, which is also a DG category, this is just in bijection with a set of objects of A. Right? If it's a functor, it sends this object 0 to some object of A, and it sends identities to identities, so where it sends the morphisms is uniquely determined. Okay, so what's one DG? It's two objects called 0 and 1. Obviously, they have identity morphisms. And then they have a single, so concretely, home 0, 1 is isomorphic to the integers. It's a copy of this free abelian group generated by a single object called F0, 1. That's my notation for a single morphism. So if I take D of F0, 1, it's closed. Okay. And so note, what's a functor of DG categories from bracket 1 DG to A? This is just equivalent. It's just in bijection with a set of all morphisms from some object x0 to some object x1, such that df equals 0, and the degree of f is also 0. So this is already picking out all the closed morphisms inside of your DG category. I'm going to define 2 DG and then the rest of DGs by picture. So 2 DG consists of a diagram like this. So let me explain what this is. So A012 is in the set of degree negative 1 morphisms from 0 to 2. And it's not closed. Rather, its derivative happens to equal the difference between F02 and the composition of F01 with F12. So what does this DG category encode? Well, it encodes the data of 3 morphisms called F01, F12 and F02, together with a higher simplex called capital A that realizes a homotopy from the composition of the two composable morphisms to a single morphism from X0 to X2. Okay. So here, A012 is in degree negative 1, as indicated. Okay. So what is a functor? I'm not going to write this down, I'll just say it in words. What is a functor out of this guy into your DG category A? Well, it's just a commutative diagram that looks like this. You can have 3 objects, x0, x1, x2, closed morphisms between each of them, and then a higher homotopy showing that there's a higher homotopy between the composition of these two morphisms with f0, 2. Okay? More generally, what's bracket k, dg, has objects 0 to k and a degree 1 minus k morphism from the initial vertex to the terminal vertex, satisfying the equation. So I'll call this a dA of bracket k. There's some sign that I'm not going to articulate. Okay, so let me explain this notation. So what does this example illustrate? I have a single morphism from 0 to 2 given by just skipping the first object. Okay, this is not 0, 1, 2, but it's 0, 2. I've removed 1. Likewise, whenever I have some sort of k-simplex, by induction I know what to assign to its faces. I know what the k-1 simplex is. And the k-1 simplex encodes some morphism from 0 to k, where I skip some ith element. Okay, some ith element in the interior, so from 1 to k-1. Okay? So these are all the ways to directly go from the 0th vertex to the kth vertex, these capital A's. Okay? On the other hand, I could have also taken a detour through some ith object. Okay? And the detour that I take from 0 to the ith object, again, this is encoded by some I simplex. So I know what to assign to the set 0 through I for this I simplex. And again, by induction, I know what to assign from the simplex that spans I to K. And so I can take those two things, and I can compose them because I'm in a DG category. Okay? So this really complicated and ugly-looking formula articulates is this gives me a notion of what it means to give a higher homotopy that interpolates between all these lower homotopies that I've specified. And then the exercise for you is that, exercise, so let's define the DG nerve of A. So it has to be a simplicial set from delta up to sets. What does it do? It takes the kth object in delta and it sends it to DG functors from the DG K simplex to A. Okay. So the claim is this defines face and identity maps just as before. Okay. Then this, the exercise is that this is an infinity category. So you see now the trick of how to get infinity categories. The way to construct infinity categories is to construct a model of k-simplices in whatever setting you want, and then you just shove them into your category A. And if you constructed your models in a functorial way, in a natural way, then this is naturally a simplicial set, and it gets an infinity category. But I need to tell you some properties to convince you that this is even a good construction. But yeah?
Yeah, so question about this 2DG, right? It's just quasi-equivalent to the category where
yes.
Throw away two of them. Right, the F02 and
A. Yeah, so this is actually quasi-equivalent to the category where if you just take, you know, if you make these equal on the nodes,
yeah.
Composition.
But then, and also functors will be the same, right? So you can use either category.
That's right, but this is, so the problem is we haven't gone into any homotopical world yet. Right, this is a set.
Okay. Because you want all these face maps.
Yeah, so this is a set. This is not some category, it's a set. So I need actually a concrete model. But you're right, like, if I were to, you know, say map into spaces rather than sets, then all these spaces of functors would be equivalent regardless of what strict model I take for the k-simplex. Yeah.
Well, the question is more just, why do you use sort of this bigger category, right, instead of...
Yeah, exactly. So the reason I use the bigger category is I want sets. And this is what makes this combinatorial rather than homotopical. And so the power of infinity categories, this definition, is that you are always allowed to just play with strict sets, strict commutative diagrams, etc., that makes some of these harder to construct. Once you've constructed one, it makes them a lot easier to play with. And you'll see, yeah. And you know, the only reason I'm going through all this is because I've never given a strict definition of the Lagrangian cobordism category in a talk. And because I'm given two talks, I might be able to this time. Okay, so let me give some more examples. Or let me just give some properties of this. Just a remark. So let's let C be an infinity category. And it's fixed to zero simplices. So C sub zero is just what I assign to this poset called zero. And this can also be called just a set of objects of C. So it's fixed to objects inside of this infinity category C. And there exists a notion of home XY. Okay? And this would be some space. I don't think I have too much time to explain in what sense this is a space. But essentially, because C is built up of a bunch of simplices, you can actually articulate, you know, all the simplices that begin at X and begin at Y. Okay? And you can consider this some simplicial gadget of morphisms. But of course, how do you build a space? Well, you have a bunch of simplices and you glue together. Okay? So it turns out that this defines for you a space called the space of morphisms from X to Y. Now, if C is the DG nerve of some DG category A, then you can prove the following. So because you have a space, you can take its nth homotopy group. Okay. And of course, when you take homotopy groups, you better take base points. Okay. Well, because we're in a DG category, there's always a unique morphism called the zero morphism from X to Y. So you can take this base point. Okay. Now, this is an abelian group. It's some invariant of the DG category. What could it possibly be? Well, it turns out that it's isomorphic to the cohomology groups of your DG category. So this is morphism in A, morphisms in C. So what you see is that this is not a complete invariant of the DG category, at least because it doesn't see any of the positive cohomology groups. But it certainly sees all the negative cohomology groups. So for instance, if your DG category happened to be pre-triangulated, this doesn't lose any information, because you can always just shift your objects up and down, and you can capture all the cohomology groups. Okay. So let me just write down another remark. There exists an A infinity nerve. Not just a DG nerve. Okay. So this construction also works not just for DG categories, but for A infinity categories. So let me just write down the formula. Again, you just need to construct a model of the K-simplex. So I'll just write down the formula of how to construct the K-simplex as an A infinity category. And you can figure out the details, because you probably shouldn't waste too much time. Before, after we wrote down the ways to directly go from the zero simplex, from the zeroth vertex to the k simplex, we wrote down all the intermediate pathways that we could take between zero and k. And so here, we do that again, except we don't just take an intermediate pathway that's broken by one vertex, we break by as many vertices as we want. Because we're in an A infinity category, we can take the mu m operation for all of those, and all the formulas will work out. Okay. So you can see that, in fact, this DG definition is just a special case of that when all the mu 3s, the mu 4s, et cetera, are 0. And, of course, there's a sign that I'm not articulating, as usual.
Yes. Yeah. For the ordinary cohomology, this little construction captures all the information from the original. Is that true for this DG category?
No, so like I said, it doesn't capture all of the positive cohomology groups.
Uh-huh.
If your DG category were something like pre-triangulated, then you'd be fine.
Uh-huh.
And so this is like very inherent to this theory. This theory relies very much on morphism spaces, and spaces only have positive cohomology groups.
Uh-huh.
Because spaces only have positive, or sorry, spaces only have positive homotopy groups.
Uh-huh.
Because spaces only have positive homotopy groups, and positive homotopy, positive homology, etc., corresponds to negative cohomology, because
yeah,
of the co and cohomology. You can only ever see the negative cohomology groups of a DG category or of an A infinity category using this construction. So this definitely loses information. My claim is if your DG or A infinity category were pre-triangulated, it loses no information and you can recover it canonically because you have a shift functor that will allow you to recover all the positive cohomology groups. let me just say, so I really want to get through more today. So, remark, let's let F0 and F1 be maps of infinity categories. So what do I mean by this? C and D are both infinity categories, so they're just simplicial sets. And I told you what a map of simplicial sets are. Okay? It's just a natural transformation. So these are just two natural transformations, F0 and F1, and a homotopy from F0 to F1 is a map of simplicial sets, C times delta 1 to D. So what do I mean by this? So remember, I defined for you what the K-simplex was earlier. It's just the thing that corresponds to bracket K. Okay, so this is the, when K equals 1. And remember, because everything lands in sets, because a simplicial set is a functor that lands in the category of sets, we can take products of sets. And this defines a new functor. Okay, so this is what I mean by this. I'm taking a product functor. And of course, there's actually two inclusions here. Into the zeroth vertex and the first vertex of delta 1. And I demand that the inclusion into the ith vertex, this composition, is the functor fi. Okay. And you can show that a homotopy between DG functors or homotopy of A infinity functors is sent to a homotopy between functors between infinity categories. And so the remark is, then any homotopy of DG or A infinity functors is sent to a homotopy of functors between infinity categories. You can try to write down for yourself how a functor of A infinity categories in the first place gives a functor between infinity categories. But I guess I'm already out of time. So next time I'll begin with another example of an infinity category. I'm going to draw some pictures, and these pictures will make it manifestly clear that whatever category of Lagrangian cobordisms I define is also an infinity category. I didn't even get to tell you why infinity categories are a good thing yet. I've just given you some constructions. Hopefully I'll be able to talk about that next time. But we're almost done with goal zero. I'm finished.
Any questions?
Is the mu m here, like the new equation, is it part of the definition, or is it?
Say that again.
Mu m in the equation.
Yeah, I mean, so I'm assuming here that you started with an A infinity category A. That A infinity category has operations called mu m. I'm saying use those to define what your simplices are.
So for the you have a deformation theory.
For these infinity categories.
Right, let's say you just have one object.
And captures the deformation. Yeah. So yeah, absolutely. So the yeah. So you don't need chain complexes to talk about deformation theory of algebraic structures. So yes, there is a deformation theory for these things. I'm most comfortable when we're actually dealing with spectra, not with just spaces, because then we have a good, you know, causal duality that we can use for spectra. But yes, in general, like if you have the formal algebraic structures that you need to do deformation theory for chain complexes, then you can do deformation theory here. That's always the case if you have something enriched in spectra. And I haven't talked about spectra yet, so you haven't missed anything yet.
So is there like obstruction?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, the point is like all this DG stuff that you do and like all these Mora Cartan equations that you write down, they often have interpretations as, can we find things so that we can attach a cell that kills some homotopy, or that kills some path, or that kills some sphere? And so like, the fact that you can find some additional element whose derivative equals all these lower terms is the same thing geometrically as finding a cell whose boundary kills off all these lower terms. In other words, all these deformation theoretic problems you can phrase in terms of attaching disks. Now the question is, do you have negative dimensional disks? Because sometimes in deformation theory you need to attach things to positive rank cohomology groups and negative rank cohomology groups. And so that's why you need to go to spectra, where you have negative dimensional spheres. In the realm of spaces, unless everything is already at the space level, and the only things that you need to attach are positive dimensional disks, unless you have this constraint, you can't do the same kind of solving for equations.
Yeah, that's thanks. It's a good idea.